What could be the impact of bio-based economy globally? That remains a question of a lot of debate. I would like to present some further insights about this question and hope to give you some inspiration to contribute to a more sustainable world. The drivers for a bio-based economy have been presented before. They are related to each other, and while many have focused on economic and environmental issues, I would like to take you to other perspectives. In the many debates, we often hear three assumptions. There's not enough land available in the world to provide enough feed, food and biomaterials, including energy, to fulfill the needs of a growing population. More so, food prices will increase when we use biomass for non-food products such as energy. And also, the environmental footprint of renewable energy is not so good anyway, due to indirect land use changes. However, if we zoom in to the question about land availability, we can find quite some evidence from renowned scientists who have calculated that there should be more than enough land available to expand our food production for growing needs and produce biomass for energy and other materials while we keep value preservation areas, natural parks, etc. in place. Worldwide, we have 1.5 billion hectares of cropland and 3.4 billion of hectares in pasture areas. On the right side of the picture, you see that there is quite a bit of room for improvement in crop harvests per area. And it's calculated that we would only need 5% of prime and not already used pasture lands to provide for the growing food needs. These pasture lands are presently often underused with low numbers of cattle per hectare. In addition to the remaining availability of prime, non-irrigated soils for non-food growth, we could also use less prime or more marginal or eroded areas for this purpose, which has the added benefit of improving the soils for other uses in the future and become more resilient to climate change effects. The second assumption is based on a belief that food prices are directly related to land availability. Food prices would rise when biofuels are becoming more abundant. This picture shows that while commodity prices were fluctuating, food prices remained stable and actually even decreased a little when biofuels production increased by over 200% and the population grew with nearly 1 billion people. The third statement assumes that the farming for non-food biomass crops will lead to new areas being used for food production. Such indirect land use changes were supposed to result in high greenhouse gas emissions, which could lead to overall negative effects in emission reduction. Here we see that the first claims of this assumption were heavily debated, and over the years more and more studies showed that such impacts, although they exist, but they are really a lot less damaging than originally expected. So overall, all the assumptions were false. This book, made by 137 authors from all over the world, under the auspices of the Scientific Committee of Problems in the Environment in collaboration with the United Nations, summarizes the evidence for these assumptions by reviewing the sustainability of bioenergy. I recommend it as reading reference. It can be freely downloaded from the website indicated. Now I'd like to spend a bit more time on the issue of food security, as this is a globally very important concern. Food insecurity still affects nearly 1 billion people. 75% of these people live in rural areas where fertile land is available. As the studies on land availability revealed, indeed, most of the additional available land can be found in South America and Sub-Saharan Africa. This coincides with the unsustainable traditional use of biomass, as can be seen on the map on the left. The map on the right shows the areas of cultivated lands in the world. And from this, we can conclude, therefore, that the majority of available land is in areas where unsustainable practices can be improved. It is well known that poverty is directly related to food insecurity. One out of two children live in poverty. And this is the growing population. So if we wish to make this planet more sustainable, we need to focus on solving the poverty. This requires, of course, science, technology, investments and equal distribution. In the view of many scholars in this field, sustainable bioenergy production can actually help by stimulating rural development, provide employment, infrastructure, leading to energy security, and as a result, leading to social development. I will even go as far here as saying that no action on this problem is unethical. Because going on as we do will deteriorate our environment. It will increase the North-South divide. It will increase natural disasters and increase food insecurity. So we really depend on social development of that growing population. Waiting for the best option is, in a precautionary principle, not such a good idea. This means that we also need more attention for better communication to avoid misperceptions as presented earlier. But we also need new governments, policies and business models that stimulate integral sustainable agriculture for food and energy in these less developed areas. This need is pressing when we consider the trends. A growing world population with a growing consumerism. In sub-Saharan Africa, more than 1.8 billion people are under 18 years old, and 15 million enter the workforce every year. The unemployment is huge, and presently, rural jobs are seen not so much as the preferred option, which leads to urbanization and the problems that come from that. To better understand these issues, a group of experts from different disciplines gathered for an in-depth study aiming to identify solutions. They concluded that the actions necessary to support the bioeconomy entail far smaller costs, actually, than no actions. They also identified some key enablers for developed and less developed countries to increase sustainability, which can be read in the joint statement that is published here. So let us look at the bioeconomy from a different perspective now. Most studies start by looking at how do we get there? What technology can we develop to solve the problem? And after that, we have developed these, we look at how we can politically support that. But we should not forget to look at the question before it. What is good? This is a moral question and relates to trust, responsibility and values, just distribution, but also perceptions and interests. And this brings us to the Sustainable Development Goals. Implementing these goals will require us to change our economy from a cost economy to a value economy. As the sustainable circular economy will depend on a circular business model, such as depicted here in this example from Wageningen University. This may be developed, for example, in biohubs, where less developed and developed countries can benefit both from collaboration. The aim of the hub is to introduce sustainable agriculture for food, feed and other biomass uses, with nutrients recycling, landscape management for improved biodiversity and soil quality to create social and rural development. Excess biomass and residues mobilization can provide really feedstock security for industrial biorefineries. Such a biohub organization is depicted here. In a hub with several farmers, machinery and training is provided, while residues are pre-treated to provide additional income and energy. More hubs together can provide for one more technology-intensive refinery, and the nutrients can be recycled to return to the farmland. The organization of the hub can address important local issues and needs and be adapted, therefore, for many different situations. We still have to learn how to best develop such collaborations, which aim for mutual benefit. And I really hope that you also get inspired by this to help to further develop such ideas. In summary, if we agree with the Sustainable Development Goals, then the Sustainable Development Goals should need to be part of the research and development agenda of every industry and institute. And we need to build sustainable agriculture with a focus on including bioenergy and bio-based products for social development. I hope you got inspired, and thank you for listening.